Hi, this is Jim Soper with Ballots for Bernie, and we are here in San Diego with Ray Lutz, and we're going to have an opportunity to talk with him about the great work he's been doing in San Diego and his recent adventures in the swamps of Florida. I will start by asking Ray to give us a little bit of background about what he's been doing for the past half year in San Diego and what's going on with his trials and tribulations.
Hey, thanks a lot. We're down here in the Bay of San Diego. It's a little bit chilly, but I'm sure we'll live through it. So basically, in the last year or so, I got started about a decade ago in this area, and this time what we've been trying to do is get the audit process really well scrutinized by oversight professionals, basically not professionals that we're paid, but this, so we know what we're doing, and that we have a procedure that we know that will really check what they're doing. So in this election, I really had a lot of questions about the audit here in San Diego, and I knew exactly how to watch it carefully, and we made the recording of their selection process and realized that it was just incomplete. They didn't have all of the ballots included, and so we asked them to include the ballots. He said no. Then we went on to trial and went through a 4-day trial. The judge has not completely ruled on it. Well, we tried to stop the election too. We tried to stop the certification of the primary, and the judge said he didn't have time to consider all the facts and he wouldn't do it until he had considered the trial. And of course, by the time he had considered the facts, we had the convention had already happened. You know, basically they had already crowned Hillary. And so they said it was moot. So when we finally got to the point where the judge could tell us, could rule on that, they said, well, it's moot, so we can't stop the election here in San Diego. We've since had the trial, and the judge is so far mostly ruling in our favor. And I think what we're talking about here is there's really four sets of ballots that come in that are scrutinized by the 1% manual tally audit. The first set is the vote-by-mail ballots, the early vote-by-mails, and hear a plane going over. If it's probably going to stop you hearing from me, I'll let it go over here. Yeah, we're pretty near the airport. So the first set that comes out at 8 o'clock at night is the early vote-by-mail ballots, the ones that are actually processed prior to election day. But before that night. And then the second ones that they process are the polling place ballots that came in on election night. Those were all included in the 1% manual tally. And then the later processed vote by mails and the provisionals were left out. And so essentially, they were excluding, now we learned now after we processed the trial, they were leaving out approximately 40%, about 39 to 40% of the ballots from the scrutiny of the 1% manual tally. And this would be something where you could easily fix the election if you had access to the central tabulator with that, because the difference between Hillary and Bernie was only 16,000 votes at the end. And the number of ballots they left out of the audit was 285,000. Cut that in half because it's only a Democratic primary, so you've got to leave the Republicans out. And so you end up with, say, 140,000 ballots, and still you can hide 16,000 in 140,000 fairly easily. So the risk is there, and so it could have been fixed that way very easily had they had access to the central tabulator, and we never would have found out. Plus, they were doing a lot of other things here that made us extremely suspicious. Michael Vu, being the guy from Cuyahoga County, Ohio, the 2004 Kerry versus Bush election, he was involved in that. And this is the one where Diebold System says, we're going to deliver your, we're going to deliver the election to you, Republicans. And so they they did, you know. And then he had to resign after that, and then he came to San Diego, where he was rewarded with a much larger county within 2 months. So, you know, in my mind, it was a reward for doing the dirty deed. And so now he's our guy that we're, you know, encountering here in San Diego. And he's basically, in this election, for all the vote by mail ballots, another plane. So all the vote by mail ballots, they, instead of setting these up and pulling the random sample by precinct, which is 1% of the precincts, that's how they do the polling place ballots, they decided to do it 1% of the batches, just batch them up with batches that are ballots that are from various precincts all mixed together. They had 1,300 of these, but only 730 as of election night. And so they pulled 1% of those 8 batches, selecting numbers. We said, you need another 8. They said, no, we're not going to do it. And that's the reason for the lawsuit. Then, after our lawsuit happened, they decided to switch from batches back over to precincts. So they ended up not doing the batches. Instead, going back to those precinct numbers they had chosen before. How do you do that? You got 730 batches in a room. They had to get a computer report that told them where the ballots were in the batches. They had 40 people work for a week searching for the ballots in the batches to pull them out and get them to match the computer report, which they had in their hand. So they weren't, you know, doing any kind of great test here. They were trying to find the ballots that would match the computer report. So the whole thing is bogus. It's completely a sham. But that's what they did.
And they say they can't do this kind of work to do hand counting, and yet they're spending a week digging around boxes to try and find the ballots.
They said we don't have enough time to do it. And also the evidence in the trial was that they had wasted a lot of time during that, because remember, they switched over from batches. They had counted all the, you know, a lot of these batches in the manual tally of the batches ahead of time, and then they decided, oh, we're gonna go over to precincts, throw all that work out, and then they started tallying the vote by mail ballots on the 27th of July. Sorry, June, 27th of June. So the election was June, 7th or 8th, and then 20 days later, they started the vote by mail tallying. They could have started much earlier than that. Why are they waiting so long? The whole thing is, makes you, when you see this and you're looking very, very carefully at it, you say, something isn't right here, over and over. So for a couple of years, I've been trying to pin this down. And one of the things I realized I needed was a data file that I didn't have. It was this, why I call it the snapshot file, because that's the name they used. And the thing is, at the end of election night, we needed a snapshot, a complete picture of the election that they're going to be tallying, selecting precincts and then tallying those precincts up. We needed a complete data file that shows all of the precincts, and then we could add up all the precincts in order to get the final numbers that they had as of election night about who was winning, and then compare just the ones that they said they had pulled with what they were actually tallying. Here's the thing. Bernie Sanders was winning like a landslide against Hillary Clinton in all the polling place ballots, 58% to 42%. Whereas in the vote by mail ballots, the early ones, the ones that I mentioned they had to search through for a week to pick them out, Hillary Clinton won 58% to 42%, the exact opposite. And since there's a few more vote by mail ballots than polling place ballots, when you, at the end of the day, Bernie Sanders won, sorry, I wish. No, Hillary Clinton won by 3.75%, only 16,000 ballots. So because there was a little bit of a differential there. It could have, as I say, all they got was a 16,000. Had you flipped those 16,000 the other way, easily Bernie Sanders could have been the original winner before they switched it and then hidden it in that vast number of vote by mail ballots that were obviously, you know, not audited correctly. So anyway, I was talking about the snapshot file that I had realized that we needed in order to figure this election out, any of these audits out. And we finally, a number of years ago, in the elections ago, in 2010, I started the research in 2008, spent 2 years trying to figure them out. Nothing is documented, you know, you have to ask a bunch of questions, around and around we go, please clarify, this takes months and months. Finally, I figured out that the manual tally law is not too bad in California, if they were doing it right, and if we had the data file to compare it with. But the fact is we didn't have that data file, so I started saying, I want that data file in advance of when you draw the numbers. That's the best way to do it. You don't want to get the data file after they've drawn the numbers. Why? Because they could have fixed the data file by then. If they had a few precincts that they had fixed, and then the random selection happened to hit some of those, they just go back in the back office, undo the fixes, make it fit, match the, you know, the paper ballots, make a new computer report, because we never saw the other one, and then give it to us. We gotta have the computer report ahead of time so they can't go fix it up. Can't back out any of the hacking that they did. So that's really important to get it before. So we don't get that though in any of the vote by mail, the batch mode vote by mail that they're still doing now. In this last election, they said we're doing it by batch. We cannot get them to give us a complete snapshot file of all the batches before they make the selection. If they give it to us after, as I say, all the batches, the IT guy is the guy who goes out and gets the ballots for them, brings them in, and hands them a computer report. All they would have to do is go back and say, hey, let's give the computer report of the one that matches. Then they dutifully, you know, hand tally. Everybody's watching all this weeks of work of them tallying. It's all just for theater. Our lawsuit is right now gone to the point where we filed additional briefs after his initial ruling, and then we're going to have another hearing, not really a hearing, it's called a case status conference on the 1st of December prior to certification. And we're going to say they shouldn't not be able to certify this election unless they do it correctly. And of course they're going to say, oh, we did it correctly enough, we don't have to do it all the way, it's substantially done. What are you trying to do? Make, and some of the arguments they gave were funny, like, oh, Lutz should have, you know, he should have filed suit years ago. What's he taking all this time for? You know, why didn't he tell us this before? Stupid things. Or everybody else is doing it wrong. And the attorney said, well, you know, Your Honor, what about if you're driving on the freeway and you say everybody else was, you know, speeding? Does that mean I can get out of my ticket? No. So the judge pretty much threw those things out. But now, right now in his latest ruling, he says, we were asking for more than 100% of the ballots to be hand tallied. The stupid thing. They were arguing because the definition of a provisional ballot is a little bit squishy, how people use that. Because when you go in, you vote provisionally, that ballot isn't cast until it goes through further scrutiny. It's a provisional ballot. Once it's validated, it's cast, and it's no longer really provisional at that point. You can still say that was from the provisional ballots. Well, they're saying that we want them to manual tally all of the provisionals, even the ones that were invalid, even the invalidated ones. And therefore, we want more than 100% of the valid ballots. Stupid, you know, but this is what the county is struggling to find a way around this, because we got them in a corner. In 2012, I said, well, I'm going to extend this plan of getting that data file to more counties. And even if you force them to produce it and ask them to produce it and they do, then it's harder for anybody to fix it because they know it could be looked at, even if we don't look at it. And I try to look at them, but it takes some work to actually dig in there, look at the exact numbers in the file. But if they know, the hackers know ahead of time, Lutz and his group, they're going to be possibly looking at this file, I could be caught. Maybe better not do it this year. So that was the idea. And so we sent that to first all of the counties in California, 58. We learned that a lot of these counties are so small. Alpine County only has one precinct. So they just hand count. They do 100% hand count. That's what they do when they do their 1% manual tally. So there's no need for a snapshot file or anything like that. That's only if it's sampled. So we decided to target the top two dozen, which is 92% of the ballots and voters. So the other 34 counties is only 8%. So to focus in, like, we'll just ignore that other 8% if we can cover the 92% with the top 24 counties. So that's what we're targeting. Same kind of idea. We said, let's do it nationwide. So that we looked at the top counties to cover 50% of the voters in the nation. 50%, you only need 175 counties. And guess what? The more urban districts, LA is the top county with about 5.5 million voters, followed by Maricopa, Phoenix area. San Diego is number 6 in the nation. Now, it isn't really fair because New York City has these 5 boroughs and they cut them up. Otherwise, it would be probably number 1. But the key thing here is to get people to go in and watch the selection. The most critical thing is the random selection has to be done after the election is, you know, they have hopefully the whole day, all the data collected would be the best. Get all the votes counted, then do a random selection of 1% of the precincts or the batches, what have you. It'd be best to do it that way. And a lot of them argue we don't have time, but that in theory, that would be the best time to do it. And then,
snapshot.
Yeah, you need the file, but if you had them all done, the snapshot file would be the final results just before certification. So this is, we said, let's do it nationwide. Now, in nationwide counties, not all of them have paper ballots. A lot of them don't. So if all they have is the electronic machines, you're SOL, you can't do it. If they, and a lot of them don't, some of them do have auditing procedures. And so we said, well, the places that have the paper ballots are way to audit, then let's use that. And let's make sure that we watch the audits really carefully. So I just got back from Florida. I know we wanted to kind of move on to the next thing. You want to go on to that, or should you want to ask a question so far? Go ahead.
I had a couple. I had a couple questions. One, the snapshot protocol. Are you trying to get the data about how many votes each candidate got in each precinct, what I call a detailed precinct report, or are you trying to collect all the logs of all the movement of all the critical pieces? And audit that too. Is that included in what you're calling a snapshot protocol?
Okay, no. The snapshot, you can do those things. What we did a couple of different levels of scrutiny. The main thing about the snapshot protocol is to be able to watch these audits carefully, you have to have that snapshot file if they're doing it at like they do in California, where they say we're going to cut it off at election night and do our first, we're going to start our manual tally right then. In contrast, Florida does their audit at the end. So they have the results certified, and then there's no real way to go back, which is a bit of a problem. But they have the results certified, and then the final file is like the snapshot file. It's very easy to obtain. Here, it's hard to get that snapshot file because they just aren't cooperative. You say, I want, and it has to be broken down by precinct, or, and preferably if they're choosing batches, list every batch and what the vote totals are for each batch. Counties like Los Angeles, okay, they sort everything by batch, by precinct. So there's no such thing as a batch. But they leave out all the late vote by mail and provisional ballots from their audit. So they have a vast number of ballots that are not included, and they're predictable. So if you were a hacker, you say, well, let's not hack the first part that's audited. Let's just hack the second part and, you know, don't waste our time. So there's a vulnerability there that it could be hacked. So what we do is we get the snapshot file for preferably the right after election night, if that's when they're going to do the audit, and then if they're going to do the second phase, which is what we're suggesting, they go on and do the later vote by mails and provisionals and get the second, which should be the just before certification final results. Now, if their machine can only make essentially totals at that time, which is what they can do, they can give you all of the precincts totaled out to what all of the races got in that precinct, race, so forth. And then later you can get the same one. You can get all the totals, the grand totals. So the ballots in between the first and the second is basically a subtraction. Take the second file and subtract the first one, and those are the ballots in the second batch. And so that's what you want to, first do the subtraction, and that should be the net number of ballots in whatever they're counting, the result. What you get in their report, unfortunately, is a variance report where they said, well, we found that there was we're up two votes here, down two votes there, and we resolved that it was a misfeed. Well, you didn't actually read the total number of votes, which is what we want. And we've discovered that sometimes the computer report that they're comparing with is not the one that we had when we first got the snapshot file. Very important. So if you were a hacker and you wanted to hack the election, how would you do it? Remember, you got to change it substantially, because if it's too close, it's going to cause people to want to investigate. So you got to get it up by a few percent. We don't have automatic recounts here. In Florida, they do. If it's within a 0.5% or a 0.25%, they go through what they call a recount, which is hardly even a recount, but we'll get into that maybe in a minute. So they have something that's automatic for further scrutiny. We don't have. But any candidate, anybody that's running, any people that are promoting a proposition or something, have the capability to go in, pay for them to go back in and do some recounting to see what's going on. That's how they handle it here. You have to have somebody that's interested to go back and do it. Now, so they don't have this automatic trigger, but still you have the threat that somebody on the other side will actually go in and check. So you got to have it up by maybe 5%. And if you're down 5%, that means you got to move 5%. You know, you got to flip 5%, which would mean, let's take this example, Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton. There was 16,000 votes up at the end that Hillary Clinton had over Bernie. Let's say you flip those and you made those Bernie's votes. Then Bernie would be up 16,000 votes instead. And so what you did was you flipped 16,000. How would you get that? Let's round it up to 20,000 votes. Well, they have 1,500 precincts in the district here in San Diego. Let's take 1,000 of them. You maybe change 20 votes in every precinct. That way you have 20,000 votes that you are flipping. So it's quite a few. You have to hit quite a few precincts because you don't have that many votes. You know, you don't want to make it noticeable in any one precinct. You want to make it so that, you know, 10, 20 votes here or there, no one's going to notice unless they really know the precinct and they know how everybody voted. They're not going to. And I talked to some people that do in a trailer park. He says, I know everybody in this trailer park, how they voted. And he says, the results were not how we said we voted. So there are, you do get some feedback like that. However, that's how a hacker might do it. And so what we're looking for is, of those 16 precincts that they count, it ain't very many out of 1,522, that we may have a chance of hitting the 1,000 that they fixed. It's a pretty good chance. It's a big enough chance that we could probably and we've got a nice child that's singing over here. It's a good enough chance that if you're an insider and you know what's happening and you know that the citizens are going to be watching another plane.
Sorry, folks.
Like Southwest. There's the plane. You can see it in the background.
Hey, that's my plane.
So if the hacker, the inside hacker, knows that we're going to be watching carefully, and there's a chance that, you know, maybe 50% of the time they might be caught, guess what? You're probably not going to do it. So that's the whole concept of snapshot. Now, what we did here for two times now, we did it in 2008 and in this election, we went back into 5% of the precincts, and we looked at, physically looked at the signatures of the voters, and this time it was 77 precincts. The other time it was 85. So we had, we looked at all those precincts and looked at the actual sign-in rosters that they have, counted how many signatures there were to figure out how many votes we should find on the, you know, in the report. And usually it matches, but I mean, we learned a lot, because the problem was that one thing we learned was that these polling places tend not to do a very good job of adding things up. Either they just really rush for time, or they just do a crappy job. I mean, the main balancing thing they have to do is how many original ballots they had, how many were voted on, how many were spoiled, how many were left over. That should all add up and equal. And only in 15% of the time did they add up and become equal. And also, you want to know how many were scanned later. That should all add up and be equal. And so it's a mess. It's an utter mess. And it leads me to believe that asking people to actually count all the ballots by hand in 1,522 precincts is not practical. Especially in a big district like this, look, if they can't even add up the ballots, what makes you think they can add up sometimes 20, 30 different issues on the ballot amongst, you know, a few, usually precincts are about, you know, maybe 400 voters that come in and vote. So getting that in the so-called the hand-counted paper ballot approach, where everybody votes on paper and that they're all hand-counted, I just have a hard time. I don't want to get rid of paper ballots. They're essential, and I want to be able to hand-count them, but I don't want to rely upon that as a first round of counting, because computers can be good at counting stuff. The problem is not the computers counting them. It is the operators hacking the computers that are counting them. That's our problem. That's what we're looking for. The computers don't lie, cheat, or anything else. Sometimes they make mistakes, but those mistakes usually self-balance and balance each other out. We're looking for the hackers, the people that want to fix the election, and those are human beings that are changing what the computers are doing. That's what we're looking for. So I think that answered your question on that. You got more about this first phase of the
still in San Diego. We'll talk maybe a little bit later about how to get some of these things dealt with in California law, because the Voting Rights Task Force, if you go to the Voting Rights Task Force Facebook page, the California page, that's going to be set up to discuss how to make changes in law. But before we go to Florida, I find it an interesting story, and I think people should learn a bit of who you were, how you just got started in addressing the legal side of what the county's doing. I mean, you're a lawyer, you're not a lawyer. How did you get going on this? We're seeing citizens now, as it seems to be a new trend, citizens just going in to courts and saying, I got a complaint.
Well, you're right, I'm not an attorney. And my background is as an engineer. I've got my degree in electronics engineering and computer science. Another plane, see him back there. And so I did work in the document processing area. So the companies I worked for we're doing, you know, printer, scanner, fax, copier, you know, document management and stuff like that. And so I knew that I had knowledge in this background, and when I got more interested in politics, which happened during the catastrophe of the Bush era, I went ahead and said, well, actually, I tried to volunteer for some things. They says, oh yeah, collect this and that and do all this work. And I realized that nobody really did anything with it, you know, and it was just a waste of my time. After the 2000, of course, everybody was interested in election integrity in 2000 and 2004. And then when Obama was elected, of course, everybody just forgot about it. But during and after 2004, when the second Bush time was elected, then people sort of forgot about it too. So a lot of these election integrity groups faded away. And also, it's a lot of time in between elections, so the people that do learn about it end up just getting too old or dying or whatever, and they're just not there. So it's essential that we get the younger folks involved so they can learn about how this happened. So for me, I started just trying to find out what the hell they did in San Diego. They had no written procedures. I said, you know, I thought it was going to be easy. Oh, give me your written procedures. You know, I'll just look them over. We don't have any written procedures. Okay, well, how the hell do you know what you're doing? You know, really? How do you improve your process? I mean, this is the number one thing. If you run like a manufacturing firm and you went to them and you said, let me see your procedures, of course they have them. Because this is number one for high quality processing. You have to document everything that you do, everything that you do. And then you decide how you can improve your process. They have nothing documented. Oh, we just kind of do it that way. Or they have really detailed documents about how they run a particular program or something, but not anything high level. I go in, Michael Vu, this guy I told you about from Cuyahoga County, is in there working. And I would talk to him for like maybe 45 minutes. At the end of it, I realized I learned nothing. This guy is able to just talk and not ever really tell you what's going on. It took a lot of work to get there, but that's sort of my background. Now, what happened was in about 2006, we couldn't get good people elected. We started a thing called Citizens Oversight, where we were encouraging people to go to public meetings, whether anything, a water board, you know, city council, fire board, hospital, you know, anything that's in your area that you've kind of taken interest in, spend one day a week, a month, or maybe 2 days a month, go to the meeting and sit there and absorb it, find out what they're doing. It takes about a year to really become proficient in what their you know, acronyms and abbreviations and how what their budget is and so forth, what they're doing. And then you're at a point where you can start, definitely by a year, you're going to find scams and all kinds of stuff going on. It took almost no time. So we started saying, well, let's just watch these people really hard since we can't get anybody good elected. We'll start going to, and then someone said, well, there's something going on in East County, San Diego, some kind of training camp. And so maybe, you know, your group can look into it. So we brought our cameras into the room. This works really important. It's very important to bring a camera in and videotape everything, you know, record everything. And nowadays with YouTube, it's cheap. So then we had tapes and everything. So we'd come in with our camera and video record the meeting. Turns out this was Blackwater Worldwide setting up an 824-acre huge paramilitary training camp. A private army, you know, that was set up by corporate America, and you know, you think about this: what's happening? The corporations are taking over. Now they're setting up their own armies. So, you know, we fought that. Of course, it became international news. We had, you know, the Guardian, New York Times, Al Jazeera comes and interviews. Of course, that blew up out of control. This guy Lutz is interviewing with Al Jazeera. He's working with the, you know, Muslim forces or whatever. So that took about a year and a half. We won. We stopped mostly it was the locals. I mean, with all these things, the local people are very instrumental. And some of those people there were just working their butts off. I was just trying to help with video recording, coming in, you know, set up the website, making sure that everything that we covered and we followed things up. And weird things happen, like at one meeting you had Blackwater on one side of the table, county people on the other side. Next meeting, the attorney for Blackwater was hired by the county, now working inside the county on the Blackwater project for the county, representing the county this time. So wait. Hold it right there. You know, this person used to work for Blackwater. Not good to have her also representing the county on the same project, you know. Oh, well, they said that, you know, this is just fine, you know. But if there's any notion of impropriety, we'll put her on other projects. Well, so what projects is she on? Really, does this make any sense? Here's a person who just fought to get in private attorney practice, set up her firm, then decided to go back to the county and take the county job in the planning commission. Who would do that? So it didn't make any sense. So we had to follow it up. What projects was she on? Da, da, da. So this kind of thing we did. We won that. We kept following it. Then we went on to other issues because it worked so well. And I did some tests. I'm just going to go to this meeting and see how well it works. Yep. Figured out a scam in no time. Meanwhile, I was also doing the election integrity investigation. Ran for office 2 times, U.S. Congress once, state assembly another time. Total waste of my time. But because I lost, you know, what good is it if you, and you get some of the issues out and some notoriety, but I had, basically, if you want to be, and you think about it, how can you be the most effective with your time? Do you want to run for office and lose? That's not a very effective use of your time. Do you want to write a blog and then try to educate people and then maybe they'll vote differently and then maybe that person will win and get into office and not be corrupted by the system and then they will actually change something way down the line if you're lucky. So we said, well, let's just go to that when they're making the decisions, get directly in there and take action. So that's kind of the MO, the modus operandi of citizens oversight, is we want to be directly confronting the officials that have control. And in the meeting, the key meetings where they're there, key meetings. And that's why we said, please go to the random selection meetings when of any states or anything that have these audits, because they're the most important meeting. That's where you need to be to make sure they're selecting the precincts randomly. If they after the election, it has to be, instead of Fresno, they choose the random selection of their precincts 2 months ahead of the election. And that was, I understand, they were forced to re-choose those in this election by the court, or by the Secretary of State finally did something. So that's sort of the background of how I got to this point. And now since we went in this time, went to the random selection meeting, as I was saying, which is the key meeting, video recorded it, realizing weren't including all of the ballots, asked Michael Vu to include the ballots. He said no, respectfully, if that helps. And then we filed the lawsuit. Now, I wrote the lawsuit because it was hard to get an attorney. This has to happen fast. So I knew exactly what I was doing. If I was going to hire an attorney at that point, basically I would have to feed him everything anyway. So I filed it quickly, then got an attorney hired to negotiate the legal system, because there's no way I could do it fast enough, doing the injunction and all the other processes that an attorney who knows the ropes, you got to have, because there's just too many ropes to get through. So this is why we hired Alan Gerasi he's a former deputy city attorney, I believe, of San Diego City, and that's a pretty high up position. And he does know the ropes. He's learning about election law and election integrity and has learned a lot, and I think is now very proficient. At this point, we're getting this case done, but we're also looking to go after Sacramento, because Sacramento did not choose random precincts at all. She just chose specific precincts that she wanted. She says those are too big, I'm not going to choose those. Those are too small, I'm not going to choose those.
You're talking about Sacramento County.
Yeah, Sacramento County in the state of California. After she testified in our trial and said how good a job she was doing, this is the problem that we have right now. You can talk about all the fancy auditing that you might want to do, but basically we're just trying to get them to to follow the law. And we don't, our theory is, first of all, we trust no one. We don't trust the election officials to do the right thing. The only thing that we trust is hard data. We have to have hard data, the data files, the results, the video recording of their meetings. This type of thing is hard data that we can actually take to court if we need to. That, I think that covers, you know, what you're asking me on that question. There you go.
I'm going to do a phone check here because some people are saying it's sticking. So hang with us for a second. So sorry if some of it, if it's sticking a little bit. We are on a Wi-Fi connection, so it should be working fairly well. This is all just, this is a great interview. I'm getting great information here. I hope the people out there are getting great information about what it takes to make a difference. And you're going after decision makers, and the Voting Rights Task Force is going after decision makers in Sacramento in a different way. And all of this combines together, and we're going to see some good changes coming. Why don't you talk to us now about, you just went off or came back from the swamps of Florida, and tell us what you saw and what you learned there. We want to know.
Okay. Well, you know, your point is pretty good first before I get into Florida about different groups doing different things, and it's something I learned at the, in the Occupy movement that I really respect, and that is diversity of tactics. People may not be working under the same umbrella. They may be working in avenues that are not coordinated, and sometimes that's a really good thing. It's really good not to be fully coordinated. As soon as you fully coordinate, then you can be infiltrated and ruined. You can also be easily fought. If you have a whole bunch of groups doing different things on their own, thinking of it themselves, it just drives the officials completely nuts. Because they can't track it, they can't follow it, they can't, you know, infiltrate it. Really important. It's kind of like, I like to think of Linux like that. Linux is an operating system that wasn't owned by anybody, wasn't something you could sue, could not be taken over by Microsoft, and it still persists. And it is because it could not be taken over, it could not be perverted, could not be bought, could not be taken to court. So it's good to have all of these groups doing different things, really important. And that's why I don't really like, people may say, oh, that Lutz guy, he doesn't cooperate with anything that we're doing. No, I just don't want to get all under one umbrella and be doing, marching to the same tune, because then it's easy to corrupt that. And this is an area where corruption can happen, you know, where you get infiltrated and screwed up. Florida. Well, we were looking for which places in the country we could be productive in the same snapshot protocol methodology. And a lot of it had to do with, first of all, they had to have paper ballots that were being audited in some fashion. And any kind of audit is better than nothing. Florida has really crappy audits. They are one race randomly selected and 1% of the precincts that are attributable to the race. So you don't really get a decent, you know, you don't really get a race that's important. You get some judge, you know, race or you know, Possum Falls grammar school supervisor or something, you know, that is, you're not going to get the presidential race probably audited. But they do have it. So we thought, and a lot of this has to do with the people on the ground, like people that are helping me in Florida. There were some really good people there that just took the ball and ran with it and said, okay, I'm going to coordinate all of Florida. And they did. And they just, you know, it's not that hard to do. You just get the list of all of the things. And actually doing the snapshot protocol on a state, not that hard, because you can ask all of the election officials for the snapshot file. Florida, you didn't even have to ask for that. It was produced at the end. So we didn't have to, you know, wrestle with getting the snapshot file, which I still have trouble with in California. They're just uncooperative. So they didn't have to, we didn't have to get them to do anything to get the snapshot file there. And then it's just a matter of watching the selection process and the audit itself. One more glitch in Florida. They have these things called recounts. They're automatically triggered if you have a half or a quarter percent margin less than those. And then if they do a recount, they don't do any audit, nothing. So you don't have an audit if you get a recount. Both the audits and the recounts don't ever count anything. The other problem, they run the ballots back through the machines and rescan them. And you know, if they were fixed before, they could be fixed again. You're gonna get the same results. So they never actually look at the paper ballots.
In Florida.
So they don't actually recount the paper ballots, even though they're there and the humans can count them. They put them back through the machines. So if it's half a percent, but not as close as a quarter percent, all they do is run them back to the machine. They get the same result. They say everything is fine. The second round, if it's a quarter percent, then they put them back to the machines and sort them into overvotes and undervotes, and they review only the overvotes and undervotes to see if there was any voter intent changes. Sometimes there would be a little marking that isn't quite picked up, but it kind of offsets. You know, if the marking is not picked up by one candidate, it probably won't be picked up by the other one, and maybe people do it about the same, kind of evens out. So you're not going to really move the totals. So we've got another plane. It's a big one, I think Alaska. So we, this time we actually got a dry run kind of in Florida because they had the primary on August 30th. The big race there, as you remember, was Tim Canova versus Debbie Wasserman Schultz in South Florida. Basically, it's Broward County, which is in the Fort Lauderdale area. And I'm sure everybody on this list knows all about the Debbie Wasserman Schultz fiasco with WikiLeaks and, you know, so forth. And the fact that the Russians hacked the DNC and gave it to and exposed potential election rigging by the Clinton campaign against Bernie. So then she resigned, but she had to still win her election. So we got another plane coming. That was in South Florida, and it was one of our interesting things. Southwest. We're right under the flight path here, and we're outside because it's even noisier on the inside. So this South Florida area we were looking at, but also some of the other areas. Now in Broward County, they had no audits left in that primary because they had a recount of some other race. The Tim Canova race, he lost by about 13%. I happened to meet with him just the day before yesterday in South Florida, and we talked all of this over, and he's thinking about a little known writ of something that he can use to reopen the case, even though he didn't challenge his election at the right time. He should have actually put in a contest of the race within a few days after the end. I think it's 5 or 10 days after the end of the election. You have to file that so you can say, I'm contesting the race. And actually, any citizen in California, any citizen can do it. You don't have to be a candidate. You can say, I'm contesting the election. Then the next steps are not as clear. You have to go in, pay them, usually to count the ballots, certain precincts or something that you want to target. And it's not necessarily that expensive. It might be, you know, $1,000 to $5,000 just to get an idea how it's looking. So he didn't do that, but he still thinks he may want to go back just because they're seeing some things that look suspicious. Anyway, we got a dry run of having people go into the audits and the recounts at that time. And so in this election, we were a little more well practiced. We knew some of the issues that were involved. So the main issues are, we only get one race and 1% of the precincts with that race. Now, that means the selection of the race is super important, because if they want to fix some other race, all they have to do is make sure they don't choose that one, they choose this race, and then that one they can fix to their heart's content. If they can do any sleight of hand, if they can do any sleight of hand to pick the race that they want, or some immaterial race, then they can fix a lot of other races to their heart's content and never have any risk of being caught. That's the first thing. And the second thing was, and this is becoming more important these days in the election integrity field, is a lot of these counties do use machines that can make ballot images. And that way we could go back, even if they don't have any recount or anything, and do it ourselves. If we can get access to the ballot images, then we could run those ballot images across our own software and look them over and do our own check of what they're doing. We do 100% review of the election, and then maybe do spot checks of the actual physical ballots to make sure that the images actually represent what's in there. That's always essential. So getting those images, though, can really improve the accessibility of the ballots to scrutiny by citizenry. So that's the other big thing. This time when I was in Florida, I went down there and happened to be kind of convenient because my mother just moved into a retirement home there and I need to see her. But at the same time, I went into Pinellas County that was doing a recount. Got the video of that, and I'm pretty sure that's, if you want to see these, are on citizensoversight.org. YouTube/citizensoversight. And you follow that, subscribe to that, and you'll see the videos that we're making. So I did video record that recount. And again, they don't recount any ballots. In fact, it was pretty hokey. They do this first logic and accuracy test. They ran 135 ballots, a very low number of ballots across the machine. Didn't look at them. And checked to see if no human being looked at the ballots. They ran them in the machine one time and then ran them again and compared the reports and said, we're getting the same result two times. And so that was the test of the machines. And so then they put these ballots in a box and never looked at them. Then the rest of the race, they don't look at almost all the ballots. They run them across the machine. Then they only look at the overvotes and undervotes to see if the machine interpreted them right. And that's it. The two candidates were for the Seminole City Council, and they were there, and they were separated by about 25 votes out of, I think maybe the whole district has maybe 500,000 people and voters, maybe 250,000 voters, and I think that city might have 50,000 people or something like that, I'm just guessing. So then I also, one of my main targets, well, we target, let's say we have a very specific way of targeting counties and states because we don't want to waste our time. The Florida counties are heavily weighted by South Florida. Because we're talking about how counties can be very important, California has, if you just take LA, San Diego, and Orange County, and Riverside, that's more than 50% of the voters in the state, just four. Florida, you take Miami-Dade, Broward County, which is Fort Lauderdale, and Palm Beach, those top three are about 30%. So it's pretty, not quite as heavily weighted there, but still very heavily weighted to the bottom, because you still have Orange County, which is Orlando, you have Tampa, which is Hillsborough County. So those are the really big ones. And then we take a few more. We got 15 counties, which are our targets. They have, I believe, 68 counties. So we're leaving, and we're up to, I believe, 88% of the voters, which is 15. So we're saying, okay, we're going to omit happen to miss the other 12%, which is the other, counties, 44 or something counties. Now, one of the places I went was Miami-Dade County. I went in and looked, and I have a video of this, but I don't think it's posted yet. of them doing a recount for one of the kind of a hot race. It was one of the I think a state assembly district, and they had a lot of observers there. They allow people to watch as they're looking over the ballots. They have two people, they have one person doing it and two people standing behind that person watching every single ballot, and the public can see the whole thing from the other side of the window. So they're very open about the one that they're reviewing. And by the way, they're only reviewing overvotes and undervotes, not every single ballot. And then they take them to another good thing that they have, which I have to compliment Florida on this one point. They have an election board, which is a number of people, a judge and two alternate judges, the election official, other people on a panel of like 12 people that review everything in the in the stuff that they're reviewing. They review all that. Instead of some place like San Diego, and really any county in California, you have this usually unelected, sometimes they are, registrar of voters, has no real, you know, he has, the people don't really elect them or anything. They don't have any feedback from the people making all the shots. Michael Vu here makes all the shots. And he can even put you in jail if he decides that you're doing something wrong. 5 years if you try to look at a ballot and an envelope at the same time. 5 years in prison. I asked the Secretary of State, will they get 5 years in prison for doing that? What does the election official get for not following the law? Do they get penalized? Do they get have to pay a fine, or go to prison? No. In fact, they didn't even know what it was. Another plane.
They can hear fine.
Oh, really? What's going on, guys? Okay. So you can hear all right even with the plane, then I'll just continue. Maybe it's not picking up the plane so well. It's really loud when you're here. So the, let's see. Yeah, so I called up the Secretary of State, and that they have the voter fraud division, you know, where you can turn people in for vote double voting or something. I said, well, what about the election fraud? Who do I talk to about election fraud? I want to report that. What do you mean election fraud? We don't even know what that is. You know, there isn't such a thing as election fraud. All of our officials are trustworthy. Everybody's there fine.
In Florida?
No, in here in California.
In California.
Okay, in Florida. So it was day before yesterday, Friday. That's the 18th of November. That's the day when they have, if they're not doing a recount, then they are going to select the random race and the precincts involved in their audit. Very, very important meeting. It isn't the actual counting of the ballots or reviewing the ballots. It's just deciding which race and which precincts are going to be chosen. That's the time when they have to fix it so that any hacking is not detected, because there's a risk that any kind of truly random process would fix it. So we went in there with their cameras, and the election official completely blew our top, had 8 sheriff's units there ready to arrest me. And all I was trying to do was see what they were doing. You know, they were 30 feet away, you know, going through the races on cards. You know, all they have one card for each race that they're going to put into a bin and then draw one out. Bad way to do it. And in our you know, guidelines or best practices, this is not the way to do it. What you want to have is a sheet with them all listed. It's very easy to show that all the races are on the sheet. You can check it, put a number by each one, and roll dice. And you can't really fix those dice. And then you get a number of one of the races, done. Instead, they're putting the individual name on a card, putting it into a bin, and then drawing it out like it's a raffle at a church. And of course, then we have to verify that all the cards are in there. Or did they leave one out of the race that they wanted to fix? So they're counting over the cards, and from 30 feet away, I couldn't see what they were doing. So I said, you know, I came over there with my camera to try to focus. Most places don't mind. You just come over the camera so you can see. Oh, this area, you're out of the area. We're going to call the police. Well, then I said, first go back and restart, because I didn't see the ones that you covered so far. No, we're not going to. You're not on the election board. You have no right to, I have a right to be here. I'm a citizen. I can see, I'm supposed to be able to see everything that you do. In fact, I own you. The public owns you and everything that you do. That's the public, rights to documents. And I learned, the thing is that I've been doing public body oversight for a number of years. I know how they run. I know the rules they have to follow. There are some real powers that citizens have in these public meetings. In California, at least, I don't know the rules in Florida, but if you're in a public meeting in California and they're looking at a document, they'd say, Section 13, line 1, that may right there, that should be a shall. Look, if you don't see that document, you don't know what the hell they're talking about. You got to be able to see that page, that section, and that line to be able to tell what they're doing. So the rule is in California, you can ask for the document. They have to stop the meeting and give you the document without delay. So there's no ifs, ands, or buts that you have a right to see what they're doing. So in Florida, that's what they were doing at the Florida thing. Going into too much detail. Go ahead, ask me the question.
We're going to stop in about 10 minutes, but we can see the feed and some of the comments coming in. If a couple of you have some questions you want to ask Ray, type them in as comments to the feed, and we'll try to get them in, and we'll have this run for another 10 minutes, and then sign off at least for the moment. But Ray, what do you think should be done next? Where do you go from here?
Okay. Well, let me just finish this one point about that video in Florida. That can be viewed. I suggest everybody should view that. It's at Citizens Oversight on YouTube/ Citizens Oversight. And on that channel, you should watch that, especially the first 10 minutes. I put it all up there because, I wanted to be able to document how the police came in and so forth too. And you may not want to sit through all of it, but I think it's all interesting. There, what we're going to do in that specific case is put in formal protests and challenges to what they did. It looks like the guy in the video is doing sleight of hand. He picks the race out of the bucket, and he doesn't just hold it up and say, this is it. He takes it and turns around, hides it, and then shows it. What happened? What? Why did he turn around? What was he doing? Was there two pieces there? I mean, the total overreaction of these people is mind-boggling. So it looks like we may be onto something in Palm Beach, Florida. This is the kind of, you can see how our techniques are working here. What we do is get into the exact meeting confronting the public officials. We're not talking about future laws, future strategies and so forth. What we want to do typically with Citizens Oversight is get directly in to where they're working and confront what they're doing. And then you can move it along, because they're making mistakes and we can push against. It's a little bit different strategy than long-term planning. How are we going to change laws for years down the road? Let's talk about what we can do right now. Look, we have a catastrophe on our hands. Most people that I know think this election was mind-blowing, basically. Nobody expected Trump to win. Really, all of the pundits, all of the polls said that Hillary would win by a landslide. And a lot of people, at least in my group of friends, didn't like either of them. In fact, maybe they thought Hillary was worse. Who knows? But I don't think she would have been. I think Trump is going to be a complete disaster. We're going back into a time period when we're going to have, well, who knows what's going to happen. I just think that it's becoming a very negative era, and there's a lot of desire to see what we can do right now, because the election really isn't over. We're still in the middle of finalizing the results. They're not certified yet. California hasn't even counted all of its ballots. San Diego still has a few hundred thousand ballots to count. So we're still in the middle of this. We still can take action on this election. But it's going to take a very specific targeting of those key states. It's not going to be California. California was already well and, you know, settled in the blue camp, if you will. It wasn't a battleground state, and no matter what you do here, it's not going to change anything. What we need to do is go to those other things and at least question it. I would like it to be questioned all the way back to the primary, when Bernie Sanders was obviously ripped off from his lead. So that would be my desire. I don't know if any of this will happen, but at least we can dream about what could happen. My belief is that we have to take a look at a few of those states, and I was just talking to Professor Stark on my way over here, because he wants to do, he has a, you may have seen the petition online to do the audit, to audit all the states, you know, and audit the election. Well, we only need to audit very specific states, and I would like to target that in so that we can actually see, not to prove the concept of the audit or just to confirm the results. We want to go in to see if those states where we can see they may have flipped, and see and test it with doing the minimum amount of work, but still testing the theory. And that's what I was talking to him about on the phone on the way over, is trying to figure out how, and that's what I'm going to try to do, is take a look at, from a statistical standpoint, which states would be the ones to pick on, you know, to do that. And so that's near term. Long term, we got to get these audits under control, and we have to get, actually I'd prefer not to have to do audits. I would rather have 100% of the ballots imaged and have them be open. It's the open ballot images approach. And in 2006, I came up with a recommendation called Open Canvas. Not open source, not open other thing, but Open Canvas, where you get to see all of the ballots. You can hand count them if you want, put them up for crowd counting on the internet if you want to do it that way. Run it across your proprietary software, doesn't matter, I don't care what kind of software it is, then compare the results. Now, so that's long term, and so laws to make sure that we get the ballot images. We still have to do audits, even if we have the ballot images. We still have to have a structured way to look at them. We have to, and that's the thing, and say, oh, we want paper ballots. We've got to have the paper ballots. Well, that's all fine, but what good does it do if you don't audit them? Michigan has paper ballots. They don't do any audits of the ballots. So they're saying maybe we should audit the ballots. Yeah, you should, because you have the paper, and people could go in and look at it after the fact. It's very expensive. And I got to say one more thing about the images that's really important. Once you make them, they get locked into optical media like a Blu-ray disc, and they can't be changed. So then you can't be monkeying around with the paper in the back room swapping out ballots, because it's already locked down. So what about other questions? I guess I don't know if we're out of time.
Take a quick look to see if we have questions. I didn't see questions come up, and we are getting a little short on time. So we'll wrap it up there with a couple notes. One, the Voting Rights Task Force, we set up a new Facebook page. If you just look for Voting Rights Task Force in Facebook, and you'll see especially a California page where we are starting to, we have a cross-link to a Google Docs page with a dozen different proposals of things we could propose for legislation for next year in Sacramento. Ballot images is one of them. And another that we had proposed before that became maybe 2824, we may re-propose getting more into the idea of actually having the snapshot protocol happen at the exact right time. When we wrote that last year, we didn't have that timing down, and I want to talk with Ray for a moment afterwards about getting the timing down. But go and join that that Facebook page, Voting Rights Task Force California, that is going to be strictly talking about legislation and regulations and what we can do to improve them. If you want to talk about exit polls and everything that went wrong elsewhere, go to Occupied Rigged Elections or Election Integrity on Facebook and discuss that there. This is going to be about focusing on making changes on solving the problems. And secondly, if you like this video, this live stream, please help support us. Go to gofundme.com/takebackthevote. We need some money to set up remote interviews. That takes some money to get the technology to put together. And we could really use that so we can start to not have to do just local interviews. I happen to be in San Diego, and so we put this together on the fly. But we want to be able to do remote with people from all over the world and talk to people all over the world and bring you these weekly live streams that we hope are very informative and bring you a different perspective on how we can make our elections better. So again, Ray, thank you very much. And we will let you say goodbye.
Yeah. Take care. So I need to plug also citizensoversight.org. There is, right now we have a matching donor that has, we still have a few more dollars to raise that will be matched one-to-one. So we get to double any donations that you make right now until we fulfill that goal that we've been working on. And then, so at Citizens Oversight is a Facebook page, / Citizens Oversight. And we also have an election team. I'd like to encourage people to sign up. There's a sign-up link on Citizens Oversight, because what we want to do is get a basically boots-on-the-ground army that can be dedicated to your local election district, get to know the election officials, hopefully be friends with them, get on a good relationship, because a lot of them are really good people. You know, they're really trying to do a good job, a lot of them, and some of them are super cooperative, others not so much, but you know, but a lot of them are really trying to do a good job. So get those boots on the ground for going and understanding your local area, not just for the top 24 counties that we targeted and the top 175 in the nation, but trying to any county, of course. If you're a local county, then go in there and do that. So that's what we're doing from an election integrity standpoint. And then that will also allow you to follow us in terms of these lawsuits that are taking place, additional lawsuits that we'll be filing in the next few weeks for this election, such as in Sacramento and other counties that are continuing not to follow the rules here. Okay, thank you.
Thank you all. We'll see you next week.